travelers and friends to today's monthly meeting for August. At this time, I would like to ask that all the participants mute yourselves. And for the new people that are joining us today, would you please put your name and your email and your phone number in the chat so that we can follow up and solicit you for our necessary trouble work. And so without any further ado, we've got a great meeting planned today. Text for our meeting. Becky, take it away.
Wonderful. Thank you, PJ. Thank you as always. And I can see a few folks are just coming in. And so if you're just coming in, if you would also go ahead and mute yourself, that would be wonderful. We love everybody and would love to be small enough and nimble enough to be able to keep everybody on mic, but we just can't do it. So let me go ahead and share my screen. And let me echo PJ's welcoming and my, what a moment it is, huh? So let me say just a little bit about the context for today's meeting. And I wanna say three things basically about by way of context for today's meeting. And one is really, really, holy moly, moly, what a moment to be alive. What a moment to be active in democratic politics. What a moment to be in Georgia working on this particular election. I am thinking so much about the last time we met and how we were really trying to buoy one another and keep each other motivated and talking about the brick by brick work. And suddenly we have an extraordinary tailwind and so much enthusiasm and so much energy and so much joy and lots of people wanting to do the work. The second thing I wanna say about by way of context is that there are 86 days between now and November 5th. And there are fewer than that between now and early voting. And the third thing is that in Georgia, Harris is still trailing Trump. So we have work to do. It is, I think, really important for us to just relish the energy that is present and relish the sense of joyful direction that is present, and be in a lot of gratitude about having that kind of energy and that kind of tailwind. And also to remember a little soberly that enthusiasm is only meaningful to the extent that it translates into votes, right? So enthusiasm is only meaningful to the extent that it translates into votes. And so our job is to take advantage of the energy and enthusiasm that are present and turn that into work that actually helps voters turn out and makes sure that their votes count and are meaningful. So let me also say something about the ways that we are, in terms of necessary trouble, that we are working to help elect Kamala Harris president. And I want to talk about three different ways, and every one of those three is represented in the agenda today. Okay, so the first way is that there may be folks, there certainly are folks, who want to work directly with the campaign, right? Directly with the coordinated campaign to help elect Kamala Harris and Walz. And we, our first speaker will speak to that. We'll talk about the very specific ways that those folks who want to work directly with the campaign can do so. The second way that Necessary Trouble is working to help elect Kamala Harris has to do with voter protection, because I think we are, all those of us who live in Georgia are all in great sober awareness and concern about election deniers, about votes being challenged, about the kind of undermining of the electoral process and system that we've seen before here. So a huge part of making sure that Kamala Harris gets elected and carries Georgia is going to have to do with voter protection work. And our second speaker will be from the Democratic Party of Georgia's voter protection team, and we'll talk about specific ways that we can help in terms of voter protection. The third way, but actually before I go on, I think we've had new folks join. If you have just joined, if you would mind muting yourself, we would be very grateful. So if you would mute yourself, thank you very much for that. Let me just mute them. Okay. The third way that we are working to help elect Kamala Harris president is something that will be very familiar to those who have been with Necessary Trouble for a while, but I know that we have some new folks here, so I want to say it very clearly, because this is a very integral part of how Necessary Trouble has always operated, which is that we believe in really efficient work. And so if there are ways that we can get a twofer, we will do it, right? So what we have always done is worked on two levels at the same time. In this case, we are working for two state house candidates, Jasmine Clark, right, to preserve her state, and Susie Greenberg, the most flippable district in the state. We are working to help elect Susie Greenberg and Jasmine Clark. And at the same time, we know that every time we get a vote out for them, we get a vote out for Vice President Harris, right? So it's a way of working for both simultaneously. And in the third section of today's agenda, you will hear a lot about, when we come to troubler updates, you'll hear a lot about the work that we are doing to help elect those two Democratic candidates, and at the same time integrate that with helping to turn out voters for Kamala Harris as well. Okay, so three ways that people can get involved. And what I want to say today is 86 days. So if you already have work that you're doing, Godspeed, that's fantastic. Is it possible to add any to that and still be good? We would love that. If you do not have work that you are already involved with, we want to really invite you to not leave this meeting without signing up for a piece of work in one of those three categories. The time, you know, the time for theoretical conversations about the election is really long since passed. And so this meeting is about putting us all to work to the greatest extent possible. And so in terms of very specifics, we are going to have, first off, Claire Scheck-Snyder, organizing director from the Coordinated Campaign for DeKalb County, working directly with the campaign to elect Harris and Walz. We are then going to be hearing from the voter protection unit of the DPG. We'll hear from Liz Barrett, who is the deputy director for elections administration. And then finally, we will be hearing troubler updates and events. And on that note, I'm also going to just do a tiny bit of introducing of Claire. Claire is a good friend. She has been a friend of Necessary Trouble for a long time. And she has been an activist and an advocate in Georgia also for a really long time. And we have so appreciated the work she has done, the work she is doing now, and the work that she'll be doing in the upcoming months. Claire, and let me also say that we really wanted Claire to come. We didn't have an enormous amount of time. Claire will be speaking for about 10 or 15 minutes, and then she has generously agreed. We may not get to questions at all while Claire is talking, but if we don't, she has agreed to stay and answer questions in the chat. And she's going to help us identify what ways people can pitch in directly to that campaign. Claire, thank you so much for coming. big gratitude and appreciation and love to you for all the work. And I'm going to turn this over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so glad to be with you guys today. I am sitting in the DeKalb office headquarters, which if you haven't come to see us yet, is at 627 East College Avenue in Decatur. We are right next to Chi Latina, and we're down from Agnes Scott on the way to Avondale Estate. So on that side of College Avenue. And right now there are about 60 to 70 people here for a postcard party. I should like turn my camera around and see if you could see all these people out there. I mean, we ran out of chairs. We ran out of tables. We can't even handle all the folks coming in. It's electric. And that is what it has been since, what, 18, 19 days ago that the ticket flipped. And I signed up in May to do the hard work of making sure that Trump didn't have another term and that it was Biden and Harris. And oh my gosh, it's just such a different story now because we have people coming in who say, I have never voted before. I have never made a political contribution. I have never supported a candidate, and I want you to sign me up for every shift. And people literally coming in saying that they will give us every off day they have until the election. I mean, you guys, it's just so amazing. And I can't believe it. And I still get verklempt. I mean, we've had three people do that today. And all the people, and this is the first time we have a baby in a baby carriage and three little kids who are doing postcards too. So it's amazing. So, and I have more good news to report for the campaign, for the national campaign. DeKalb County is number one in the state for active and retained volunteers. And we are also number one in the country. We're number one. We are blown it away. It's just, I think it's like the first time I'm saying it to a group and I'm in tears. It's amazing. It's amazing to see. And I think, and also we've had 10,000 people since the rally in Atlanta for Kamala Harris express interest in being volunteers and supporters. So that is very exciting too, to have, and we need your help to reach out to all of them. So I am hoping that you will be able, oh my gosh, I'm just crying. I can't believe it. We need your help to reach out to all of them. And so what we're asking people to do is to join in phone banking. And these are calling friendlies. It's calling these people who have expressed interest, and they're literally coming to us from all over. And when you put in 30330 and text join to that, it will, and you put in your zip code, it sends us, sends you to the opportunity to canvass with us or to phone bank with us, or just to volunteer and to host an event. And we have so many emails and phone numbers coming into us that we just can't get back to them. So we need your help. And I will put a link in the chat for you to be able to sign up to do that. We have an auto dialer going right now that is calling people throughout the state because DeKalb is in first place. We give 2 hours of Saturday and Sunday to helping reach people in other counties to give them a response and an answer and connect them to ways to sign up. So we're doing that right now, and we have a whole nother room full of people doing that. So it's some really exciting time, but I also need to tell you about the other things that we're doing as far as if you choose to canvass with us and if you choose to phone bank with us. We really are trying to listen more to our voters and to people that we're calling, instead of pushing an agenda or telling them to vote for Kamala without listening. We introduce ourselves and say that we're volunteering for the Kamala and Walls, or, sorry, Harris and Walls campaign, and that we are trying to elect Democrats up and down the ballot, and that we've had so much volunteering, had fun volunteering, that we hope that they would join us. And then we stop and we say, how are you feeling about the election? And we stop and we listen. And it is absolutely wonderful for people to have an opportunity to connect with somebody else to say how they feel. And if they're excited and thrilled, then you let them gush and you gush too. And then you ask them if they would sign up and join in the effort to help get them elected. And if they say that they're undecided, you say, okay, tell me more about that. What does that mean to you? You know, just, and we stop again and we listen. And then if they say that they are, you know, absolutely against Kamala, it was funny. We had somebody on the phone yesterday who was a staunch Republican, and organizer just killed him with kindness. And she was kept getting more and more pissed off, and we could all hear what was going on, and that was kind of delightful too. But she, we talked to everybody, but we really pretty much hang up, try to close the conversation pretty quickly if we happen to get a Republican. But it's not very often. We really are calling the thousands of people who have expressed interest in joining. We also are encouraging people to vote early in person. And I know that you have someone from voter protection coming to talk to you next, but everything that's going on with the state election board, people are hearing about that from us or hearing about it in the news and are coming in. And parents are saying that they're going to be bringing their kids home from college and that they're going to vote together as a family, that they're not going to risk an absentee ballot. And we really are asking people if they must request an absentee ballot, to do it as early as possible. And if they don't get it, that they make arrangements and that we will be trying to help people get to the polls. And I think that that's going to be a big job for us, but we are telling everyone to vote early and in person. And we are also telling people to check their registration every day until the election and to know how to do that. And I have 5 friends of my own so far. And when you become the organizing director for a county, all of your friends message you and ask if they're signs and, you know, all the things. I'm like, you can't be friends anymore. You have to, you can't text me about that kind of stuff. But my friends have been texting to say that they want to check their registration. 5 friends have found that they are inactive in the last week. 5 friends. And so it's happening. I can attest to it. I know 5 people who are my friends who have found that they're inactive. And I told them that they needed to call their local county board of elections. Don't call the Secretary of State. Call the local board of elections first. But it's happening. So we need to be aware and on the lookout and make sure that we're telling everybody that they need. We're going to win in a landslide. I feel confident that we are going to do that, but it's going to take a lot of work. The one other thing I want to tell you about is that in South DeKalb, we've been out canvassing the last couple of weeks, and we run into a lot of people who don't know who Kamala Harris is. And that is, reminds me of my privilege of being able to sort of stay abreast of the historical events that keep happening every other day, it seems. A lot of people aren't in that world and need to know that there is a new person on the ticket, at the top of the ticket, and who Tim Walz is. And a lot of people really don't feel like it's important to vote, that what difference does it make anyways? Look at my neighborhood. We don't receive any attention, any services. When I was out canvassing in South DeKalb, I actually fell in a hole in the sidewalk. The manhole cover was not on, and I literally Looney Tuned down a manhole. Like 50 people saw me, and I managed to catch myself before I went down, but I chipped my ankle and I'm covered in bruises. I was just amazing. But you can see why people would feel that they aren't getting an attention, the attention that they need, and their voices aren't being heard. And so that is a real thing. And we are going to be working here in DeKalb County with the future CEO, Lorraine Cochran Johnson. She has agreed. I called her and told her what I was hearing. And Lorraine Cochran Johnson has agreed to do 5 listening sessions in each district. And we are going to invite the state reps and the state senators and city council members and make sure that they all hear what's going on in their community. It will be moderated. It will be probably someone reading the questions, and we'll, you know, try to get in as many as we can. And it's Lorraine and others' jobs to say that they've heard these issues from top to bottom. And if they can address which arm of government would be able to solve them, they can do that. And then at the end, it will be a democratic function so that we can talk about Kamala Harris and Tim Walz and other Democrats on the ballot and say, this is what real representation looks like. And this is what talking to your elected officials looks like. And so we hope that you will join the Democratic Party and support these people who are up for election in November. So we have a lot going on. This is a truly coordinated campaign. We are coordinating with the DeKalb Dems. I am asking the precinct captains and the block captains to guide me in hitting their neighborhoods and knocking their doors. We are standing up a volunteer leadership program here in DeKalb, where we will have canvas leaders and phone bank leaders and postcard leaders to train people as they come in, plug them in to what they want to do. And I hope to have neighbor to neighbor door knocking, and that you can come in. I will put the word out and say, we're ready to have you come in. And people can come and request that their neighborhood be cut and the turf is cut. We will give them Kamala Harris literature, and we will we'll send a candidate out with them if the candidate wants to go, but we'll say, get it knocked in a week and bring it back. And then if you want to do an adjacent community that we haven't had knocked yet, we would love for you to do that. And you can say, I live over here. I live a couple of blocks down or a mile down the road. Take a left at the McDonald's. You're at my house, but I'm here to be your voting resource. And you can ask for me on next door, and I will tell you when it's time to vote absentee and when it early voting starts. And if you're having questions, you can call your neighbor. So we're hopeful that we're going to be able to set that out in the next week. Big hopes. And that we will also be able to open a South DeKalb office within the next couple of weeks, and hopefully a North DeKalb office. But we're under a budget freeze right now until they figure out how to spend all the money they've raised. So I think that's pretty much, I've said a lot, but there are a lot of ways to plug in with the campaign. And it is really a community-based grassroots effort. And it is so exciting.
Claire, thank you so very much. Thank you for all of that. Thank you for the incredibly important work you're doing. Thank you for all your good heart and organizing capacity. And just to kind of reiterate, if people, no matter what people want to do, it sounds like what you're most looking for right now is phone banking to potential voters or volunteers, and that no matter what people want to do, they can text 30330 and say join. Is that right? Is that the best and most direct route to actually doing something?
I actually think that I'll put a link in that will narrow it down to DeKalb, but okay. You also can just go to mobilize.us and then put in your zip code, and you'll be able to find any event near you. But if okay. You want to plug in with DeKalb, yeah. Yeah, I will send you the quick link for that, for Mobilize.
That would be great. If you could put it in the chat. And let me say for everybody that we will also be sending these links out after the meeting and the update. So if you didn't get it right now, that's okay. We will send it out. And Claire, if you don't mind, if people have questions, can they just drop them in the chat? Can you hang around just for a little while for the chat?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Beautiful, beautiful. And let me also, just as a reminder, we are focusing in terms of necessary trouble, we're focusing our efforts related to the coordinated campaign in DeKalb County for a couple of reasons. One is that we have a number of troublers that are very involved in the DeKalb Dems. And many, not all necessary troublers live in DeKalb County. And just a reminder that it was DeKalb County that pushed Biden over to the mountaintop the last time. So DeKalb County is crucially, crucially, crucially important. Before we move to the next piece, I want to just reiterate, if anybody is new to Necessary Trouble, welcome, welcome, welcome. We are so happy to have you here. And we would love it if you would put your name and your email address and even your cell phone in the chat so that we can follow up with you after this meeting. And let me also say that that I'm going to now turn it over to Leslie High, who is the troubler, who is one of our leads in terms of the voter protection work, and she will introduce our next speaker. Leslie, it's all yours.
Becky, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Liz has just gotten in touch and she's having trouble getting her slides up.
Okay. I
emailed the link.
I'm on the call now, Pat. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, are they working?
I still had trouble on my end, but I'm on the call via my phone. And then I sent Pam my slides and she's going to be my like assistant.
Beautiful.
I'm not
Thank
sure.
You.
Actually, just to let you know, I sent the slides to Pat and Becky and someone else
okay.
who are more technologically efficient than I am here.
I will pull them up right now.
This is Karen McCallan. I'm sorry. And because I just tried to open them, I'm the other person that Pam sent them to. I didn't have edit access.
No.
Don't know that
no.
I can open them. So you may no, need no. to give Becky access.
Yeah,
to
yeah,
them.
I got it. I got it.
Okay,
I got it.
Perfect. Thank
Pat,
you. Sorry.
I can give it to Pat. Who's going to be the person? Becky or Pat?
Becky.
Okay.
And it's Becky
yeah,
Butler.
Second.
You if
yep,
you have
second,
my email address.
Second. One sec, let me.
Oh, here we go. I got it.
There you are.
We got it.
Okay.
I think.
I just sent it to you, Becky, actually. I just gave
yep.
you permission, so you should be able to open it. Yeah. Thank you
okay.
so much.
Absolutely. I'm gonna share it now as Leslie introduces you.
Okay, hello everyone. My name is Leslie High. I'm the co-chair of Necessary Trouble Voter Protection Activity, and I co-chair the team with Pam Wuchet, whom you just saw speaking a minute ago. And it's once again my great honor to introduce one of the leaders of voter protection from the state of Georgia. Liz Barrett is here, as you saw, and she's been on our Zooms before. You may recognize her. And she is the deputy director for election administration for DPG voter protection. And it's incredibly generous of her to be with us, given all that's going on in Georgia right now. Just a quick note, I think we all expected voter protection to be important in this election, but I don't know that we could have estimated how important as we see what's going on at the state election board and with voter challenges. So Liz is going to tell us about some of that, but she's going to give us an overview of what DPG voter protection will be doing and in what kind of sequence. And the bottom line is she's going to tell us how each of us can plug in to that activity. As you listen to Liz, please think if you have questions, put them in the chat because we have time for a little Q&A after Liz speaks. So Liz, thank you very much and take it away.
Thank you so much, Leslie. And thank you, Pam, Pat, Leslie, for helping through this little technology hurdle, but we're going to get it done. So hello, everybody. Thank you for having me today. As Leslie just said, I'm with DPG Voter Protection. I'm also with Harris for President with the coordinated campaign, as well Voter Protection. And it's a pleasure to be here today. If we could go to the next slide, please. Okay, for our agenda that we'll walk through today, I'm going to give an overview of voter protection, the structure of the organization, and how that plays out with you all in terms of activities to sign up and participation. We're going to talk a little bit about, we're going to do state election board light, because that is the new frontier in voter protection right now. We'll talk about getting ready for the next meeting that's coming up. It is one of the high priorities. And then how you all can be a voter protection ambassador, how you can be present, be part of every stage of the election process, starting really now, and very much needed, very much needed. So it is very much of the moment for people to join in and for us to bring this win home all together. So we're going to go to the next slide, please. Okay, so for some folks maybe who are new, what is voter protection? Voter protection, first of all, Georgia was the first state to have a year-round voter protection department in the country. And what we've been building this past year has been truly amazing. Voter protection works to ensure that every voter has access to the vote, that every vote is counted, and every win is certified, right? We'll have more to say on that. To the next slide, please. Okay, here. So again, we work proactively to expand voter access. That could be asking for longer hours in early voting, right? To have hours 8 a.m. to 7 p.m., Saturday voting, which now we know is guaranteed by law, maybe Sunday voting, the ability to get at, easy access to an absentee ballot, easy access to the polling place, right, to make it not be a burden for voters. We work to prevent election subversion, to stay in correct information. Correct information is super important. There's a lot of conversation. Somebody just texted me and said, when we did our cure in 2020, was that the amount that the number of votes that Trump talked about? No, it wasn't. We cured a lot of votes, but it wasn't that number. So there's just about like election subversion can even just be the conversations we have and the confusion. Another aspect, promote effective election administration, right? All the pieces, the literally nuts and bolts steps of conducting an election. How can we support effective, efficient election administration? And of course, as we know, we want to support Democratic wins. The more Democratic wins, the more we have a voice at the table in all aspects of our lives. Next slide, please. Okay, so I wanted to just give a little bit of a picture of the voter protection ecosystem. So voters, volunteers, stakeholders, you all are directly interacting with the DPG voter protection team. We do not have a whole lot of layers in between you all and us. And that's pretty terrific because we are available for questions, we're available for engagement, we're available for support, right? We can work very closely together. And then where does that information go? Number one, we're formulating strategies. Like we're working on different strategies right now, say about the state election board, right? Or strategies about How are we going to ensure that college students have an easy path to voting in the fall, right? Not a lot of burdens for them, right? We look at strategies. What are our priorities that are going to help get out the vote? Voters have access, votes get counted, wins get certified. And then some of our overall kind of buckets or departments, election administration processes, right? How's the election office literally doing the tasks for elections? The next is voter access. One of the things that we've done is we formulated a voter challenge task force. You may have been hearing a lot about challenges happening across the state of Georgia, voters being challenged. We created a task force. We've done a deep dive in the law, and we are doing a lot of work on the ground with BRE, county BRE organizations. Then during voting, right, we've got programs like Poll Watcher and Hotline. The hotline supports voters with questions they have. They get individualized private support, poll watchers, eyes and ears in all the polling locations. And then for the results, some of the post-election activities we do to ensure certification, we will have monitors when they're processing paper ballots. We will have monitors in the tabulation area. We will also have, we're gonna shepherd all those votes across the finish line, right? Provisional ballots. Right, folks that have to take a second step to get their ballot counted, that's the cure process. So these are basically the fundamental pillars within the department and the activities that we engage in. And that the only way we engage in these activities is through volunteers, because this takes thousands of people, hundreds of people at the very minimum to do. And that's our volunteer folks. Next slide, please. Okay, so we're going to go, okay, who does DPG interact with? Again, very little in between us. We are DPG voter protection. We are interacting with DPG, with the national party leadership, state and national party leadership, okay? We are working with state and national legal counsel. We are working with the Democratic County Committees. There's 159 counties. We don't have Democratic committees in every county, but we work statewide with those county committees. We also work with County Board of Elections, BRE. And right now we are having the pleasure of participating and going to the State Board of Election meetings, which is, we're also participating at that level, right? Elected officials, we work with elected officials. And of course, we interact with the Georgia Secretary of State, which oversees elections in Georgia. So just the thing to understand is there's very little between the world, volunteers, voters, and stakeholders. They interact with us, and then with my team and my colleagues, we have direct access to the key decision makers and the key people who are involved in our elections and voter protection for Georgia and for the country. Thank you. I'm ready for the next slide. Okay. So protecting the vote here in Georgia, as I call it, the next frontier, the State Election Board. This is the latest, focus on the State Election Board is something very purposefully that the GOP is leveraging in efforts to suppress the vote and to undermine certification here in Georgia. What they have identified is that citizens may submit proposals for new rules. You could, I could, we could write something that says, hey, I have an idea for a new rule about how elections should be done, right? We've got Charlene Alexander. She has an idea. She, you know, we want to take the ballots out of the scanner and we want three people to count them and match them up. Oh, okay. So she submits a rule. Well, it's a lever that we have not engaged with, to be honest with, and we are now responding to what the GOP is doing in a very deeply organized fashion. But these guidelines that are being proposed, I think we could easily say are based on extremism. They are based on a stop the steal mentality. And the burdens that could potentially happen for the county election staff, right? They're making these new rules about how elections must be done. That means the county election staff offices are going to get a whole new set of guidelines that they're going to have to train their people on and become proficient. And what that does is that increases the possibility, the likelihood for irregularities. In order to not certify, you do not need fraud, right? You need irregularities. And so we have a jeopardization of the certification of our results, basically kind of over our head right now. And so that's why I wouldn't focus on something like this, give it so much airplay. But for the fall, this is going to come into play. And we are right now trying to engage with as many folks as possible to activate our community to weigh in with the state election board. If we can go to the next slide, I'm going to just show this slide here, really, not to personalize this, but there's four people with red and one person with blue under their name. There's one Democratic appointee. Everybody else has been appointed by the GOP. The chairman, John Ferrier, has been the more measured person, but that's 2-3. So we've got a challenging situation, and it's very important that if you are available on August 19, okay, I have to check the date. I think it's August 16. I have a slide at the end that you all can, as many people as possible can attend, but we'll talk a little bit more about that. We could go on to the next slide, please. Okay, calls to action, right? That's all the, wow, what are we gonna do? We can wring our hands, man. Listen, voting in Georgia, voter protection in Georgia, there is nothing like it in the country. We are fierce, you are fierce. We rise to the occasion. It is astounding the amount of participation that happens in this state. People come from around the country to participate in the state. So we are going to meet every challenge we face, together. So let's go on to the next slide. Calls to action for sure. Okay, so here's some of them. Sign up to attend. We have an SEB prep rally, right? We're going to prepare for the next SEB meeting, which according to my notes is the 19th. Okay, there we go. The prep rally is going to be Tuesday, August 13th, 6 to 7, a Zoom. Going to get all the links at the end, so don't worry about it. Going to get all the information. So come to the prep rally, because we do need to coordinate ourselves. So that's what that session is for. Then we ask, hey, please go to the meeting. We need to attend the next SEB meeting. You know what I'm having? Let me just check one thing here. Yeah, it's the 19th. Okay, I was just having a moment of panic that I got the date wrong. Okay, and the building opens at 7 a.m. Really, the state capitol opens at 7 a.m. and we need to be there at 7 a.m. No, because there's only limited seating. And what happens is they fill the room, and then there's kind of this swell of things that happens. The meetings tend to kind of collapse a little bit in how they run them. So sometimes they start asking for people to raise their hand, and there's only certain people in the room. So if they're going to take a hand vote, we want to be in the room. So it's a long day, and this is something new that we have not focused on before, but we are putting the rallying cry out. The good news is also we are asking folks to, if they're comfortable, make public comments at the meeting. We have a communications coaching session for folks. All that's going to be following. And then, of course, sign up to be a voter protection volunteer and to come through our pipeline. There is the pipeline that is for state and the campaign voter protection, and we ask that you come through that. And then you can get assigned to various roles, which I'm going to talk about next. If we can go to the next slide, please. Okay. Tried and true. We all know poll watching, right? Go out and observe while voters are voting. We have early voting, which starts October 15th, right? We're going to go through November 1st, and then we're going to have Election Day. Eyes and ears on the ground. When you're a poll watcher, you are using your phone to report in anything that you're seeing. And we have like a, we call it the boiler room, but it's like a, you know, we can see the whole state all at once. All information's coming in through the poll watchers. Poll watchers are eyes and ears on the ground. If we don't have a poll watcher, we don't know what's happening. We don't know what's going well or what's going wrong. This will be starting, poll watching will start October 15th. So that means there's going to be training. I've got links for you. Right? There's going to be Zoom training. There'll be on-demand training. Poll watching is, when you're a poll watcher, you are part of the official election process. By law, you must be credentialed. You must be trained and you must be credentialed through, through the Democratic Party. Typically that happens at the state level. DPG will do the certification letters, the credentialing letters, but there are also some counties that do their own credentialing letters. The important thing is whether we have self-organizing counties or DPG and national, we all need to work together. DeKalb works together with us, so I don't have to speak too much about that. But it's really important that we have a very integrated fabric together this fall. So poll watching, you can do half-day shifts. You can say how far you want to go from home. And we've got 3 weeks of early voting, right? And we've got election day. So we've got a lot of poll watching shifts to fill. We need thousands of people. Look at your calendar. What's going to really work for you? What's going to work for you, right? Oh, I don't like to drive at night. I'm not a morning person. Like, really lean into it. Pick a couple of shifts, days and times that works for you and sign up. Okay, let's go to the next one, please. Another way to get active, you could be one of the hotline folks, one of the hotline operators. We're going to get that stood up live August, September, towards the end of the month. That's the number, the hotline number that we will have on signs, we'll have on cards. It's for voters. It's the voter hotline. Voters get one-on-one, private, individualized information. So you're going to answer calls from voters who have questions about voting or have experienced a voter issue. And then also we do use, we use something called Telzio, which is the system. So your training would be twofold if you wanted to be on the hotline. The training would be on how to use the technology, which is Telzio, and you can do at home, right? And then you'll also be trained on content and different resources that you would use during your shift when you were a hotline support person. We could go on to the next slide, please. Okay, what's another way? County Liaison. That's a program that I oversee. This is something that's ongoing. County liaisons attend their local Board of Election meetings monthly. They build relationships with county level election officials. Our county liaisons are first point of contact when we need county level information, and they help us problem solve. So the county liaison program is not bound by voting. It exists year round. If that's something you're interested in, we have teams for the metro areas, but we are always looking to have people join us. And that's something that I'm more than happy to have conversations with folks. We can go to the next slide, please. Okay, vote review panel and ballot duplication panel. So some of you may have done this. This can start as early as in October. It's not the beginning of October, but this process will begin in October. So let me just clarify the timeline there. This is where paper ballots come in, right? Either people mail them in, or they put them in a drop box, or they drop them off at a polling, or they drop it off at the election office. The paper ballots, right? Those ballots have to be processed. So those would be opened up, right? That's called paper ballot processing, right? And what then happens is if there's any issues with the ballot, maybe somebody circled a name instead of filling in the little circle, right? What the vote review panel folks do is they adjudicate, they look at the hand-marked paper ballots, and they together. Usually on the panels, there's Democrats and Republicans and an election staff person. They all look at it and go, yep, we can see they circled Harris's name. They didn't fill the circle in. Okay, we can all see that they meant to select Harris. Okay. So that's vote review panel. We need volunteers for that. We also, there's something called ballot duplication panels. When they're opening up the paper ballots, sometimes they're ripped, they have coffee all over them, and you can't put them through the scanner. And there's assistance in duplicating, creating duplicates for these ballots. So usually you'll sit on a panel, as I say, with your fellow Democrats and Republicans, and you will look at paper ballots and make assessments, which is adjudicating, or you will help with the duplication of any ballots that need to be redone so that they can go through the scanner. This is a very organized process. In most counties, the metro counties, we have captains who oversee this. And this is going to be super important. There's going to be far less paper ballots, of course, than in 2020, because we're not in COVID and we've had trouble with the mail, and we have different things that have, you know, sort of made voting by mail and by Dropbox a little bit less available for voters. But this is going to be absolutely a key role. Okay, next slide, please. And ballot cure, getting a lot of questions about ballot cure. So you're going to, this is, if I go to vote and I leave my ID at home, what is supposed to happen is they're supposed to say, you can cast a paper ballot, a provisional ballot. You can fill out your choices. They're going to put it in a bag that says provisional. And then at the polling place, they should tell me, you have to now come in and bring proper ID, either email it or bring it in person by 5 o'clock, November 8th, right? I get set instructions, right? Now, what happens is that happens, say, election day when I go to vote, right? Ballots have until November 8th to be cured. Election day is Tuesday. The deadline for curing provisional ballots is Friday at 5 o'clock. So typically in those, that 3-day span, that is very much a traditional time for voter protection to conduct ballot cure. We would go down the list. We would see, okay, here's all the people that voted provisionally. Hey, Liz, did you have a chance to go into the election office or to send your ID? And we know that you need to do that to get your ballot counted. Oh, wow. Thanks so much for checking in with me. I really forgot about that, right? Ballot cure. So there is going to be a process of ballot cure where we contact voters. We help them fix a problem with their ballots to make sure that the ballots which they have filled out can be counted. Okay, so those are some of the different roles where we need volunteers, different activities where we need volunteers, where you could participate. We're going to go to the next slide, please. Okay, now we're past November 8th, right? We voted, the election day was November 5th. We had until November 8th at 5 o'clock to cure those provisional ballots and those absentee ballots. The day for certification in Georgia is going to be November 12th, Tuesday. Okay. What's going to happen is we are going to need monitors. We're going to need monitors for, as I was just talking about before, the opening and the processing of the ballots, right? The opening of the paper ballots. We're going to need monitors for after the election is done. There's something called risk limiting audits. There's a hand count of ballots, and the number of ballots that will actually be counted will be determined at the time. It's supposed to be determined statistically, but we don't do anything uniform here in Georgia. We've got 159 counties, and sometimes there's 159 different ways to do a risk limiting audit. But we're going to need monitors, people who are credentialed by the party, by law, and who can be walking around when these very important processes are happening. The risk limiting audit, we may even have a recount. So that would be after November 5th. right, after Election Day, and it's a TBD, it's a to be determined, but monitors are going to be very important. So maybe you do a couple of shifts of poll watching up front, right, and during early vote, and then after Election Day, you sign up as a monitor. There'll be more information about this. We'll have more guidance. It's going to be organic in terms of what's happening. We will create monitoring programs as we become, knowledgeable about what are the election admin activities that are going to be happening after November 5th. But you should be, it would be super helpful for you all to be thinking about the front end of the process and the end of the process, right? It's a timeline, and we're going to need folks along the way at different points. And you also have to have your own life, and you have to take care of yourself, and you need to rest, and it's a lot. But seeing the timeline, I'm hoping, is helping you to look at your calendar from October 15th through November 1st, which is early voting, and see when could I participate? When could I volunteer? Then you could look at Election Day, possibly, and then after Election Day. And those are our like three chapters time-wise, okay? And create something that's reasonable for you, and also to be able to be VoPro ambassadors. And I've shared a lot of information with you, but being able to share this with your community and your network, right? Like, we're hoping you'll tell a friend, and you'll tell a friend, and they'll tell a friend, kind of thing. Okay, we could go to the next slide, please. Okay, and then we have a new special category, which is VoPro Research and Special Projects. And this is how we've recently been talking to Pam and Leslie about this in particular, which is VoPro Research. We have some activities, we need data all the time to try to understand what's happening across the state and what's happening in election offices that impacts voters, right? And is going to impact how they carry out the election, right? How voters have access, right? We're trying to always understand what is going on across 159 counties. So we are standing up a VoPro research team, volunteer research team. And we are looking for folks who could spend between 5 to 10 hours a week. It'll sometimes be rapid response that needs to be done like ASAP. There'll be some things that will be done every week. There'll be just some regular tasks that will happen on a weekly basis. And then there'll be some pop-up special projects. And this will require doing mostly internet research, being able to interact with the Google form, not create it, but just be a user of a Google form. It will also, there was one other piece, and then making calls, like calling to election offices. This is going to be under the umbrella of voter protection. We are going to be a very uniformed team that we know who's on first base, who's on third base, right? If I have somebody like my county liaison going to the Board of Election meetings, they're going to know who their VoPro research volunteer is, right? Because that's going to be organized at a county level. That's going to be part of the VoPro team at the county level. And everybody will know who each other is. Who's on third base? Who's on first base? Ah, so-and-so is out in outfield. Because as one of the things that's very important that we're going to face is as we approach November, we're going to want more and more information. And the election offices are going to get more and more busy, right? And so we're kind of at odds. We're tapping them on their shoulder to interrupting them when they're working. And so that relationship is very delicate, how we manage it. And so working as a team together amongst ourselves is very important so that we try to streamline our interactions, our questions, and we try to do it in the most respectful way so that we get the best information back, right? And we can be as effective as we can, which is really based on protecting and being respectful of those relationships. So that's a really big piece of the conversation that we talk about with VoPro Research and Special Projects, as well as in the County Liaison Program. Okay, let's see. Next slide, please. Okay, I can't see it because the chat is in front of it. There we go. All right, excellent. Next steps, trainings are starting. So we are going to have a list of links for to share with you. There's going to be a way to sign up as a VoPro volunteer. There's going to be links to go start doing what, so you want to get, so you want to be involved with voter protection. There's a video for that right now. There's going to be training to be a poll watcher, right? These are things that are starting right now. Okay. And, we're in it. We are in our season right here for Georgia. So next steps, trainings are starting. There will be information coming forward, absolutely, and things are rolling. So you will get these links shared with you after this meeting for sure. If we can go to the next slide, I think that's it. Let's see. Yep, that is going to be it. So in terms of any questions, I covered a lot of information. I know there was some questions in the chat, and maybe somebody could help me with those.
Liz, I have a list of the questions. This is Leslie.
Great, Leslie.
First question, regarding the SEB on August 19th, will there be virtual access as well as attending in person?
Yes, there is a live stream of that meeting. Comments can be made via email as well, but yes, and that will be on the SEB website, and I do not have that live stream link here, but you will find that if you go to the SCB website and you go to notices, meeting notices, it'll be there. It's actually one of the things that's not terribly hard to find.
On that point, Liz, the last time we tried this, a lot of us had trouble getting on that platform. Do you know if they're still going to use that Microsoft Team thing?
No, Microsoft Team was a pop-up. They usually use a different platform. That Microsoft Team was the reason they used it is because they were all on Teams. They weren't in one place. So they use Teams for that reason, but usually they're in one place, and the live stream typical link will be available and will be fine, I think.
Great. Mm-hmm. So troublers, don't give up on them. Second, from one of our experienced troublers asking, will attorneys be assigned to a specific poll watching teams as was done in the past?
That is definitely underway. We need to, there's two ways to answer that question. One is to say yes, in the boiler room, right? So the boiler room, when there's voting going on, there is something called the boiler room. And this is made up of lawyers, this is made up of voter protection and voting experts. And what we do is we sit in front of our computers, we're in a Zoom meeting together, and we may be in person usually when for the big elections we're in one room. And we are, again, poll watchers are putting their entries in through an app called LBJ, through a system called LBJ. It's not actually an app. And we get to see big boards, right? We get to see everything that's happening across the state, right? And we're working as a team. So in that fashion, we will have lawyers there. Hopefully we're going to have some lawyers on the ground. That is definitely something that I think would be really important in trying to get that off the ground.
Okay, thank you. On the vote review panels and the duplication panels, DeKalb County evidently seems to think that it's mostly going to be for attorneys as opposed to volunteers. One of our volunteers actually has talked with them, and that's how this came up. So
who did you, I'd like to know who they spoke to and maybe lower.
Kate, can you put that in the chat for us, please? Whoever, if you have the contact that kind of seemed to be misinformed. Oh, that's Kate King. Okay.
Yeah, it's definitely not, that's not a requirement, nor will it be that way for sure.
Okay,
Elizabeth Burns, sure. Okay, I know Elizabeth. Yeah, it's not going to be, that's not the structure, the necessitated structure. The necessitated structure is you have volunteers, they can be lawyers. Now, it may be that DeKalb has decided they are going to hand select some of their volunteers. So I would have to talk to, I'll have to talk to Elizabeth and get a little more information on that. But by and large, you do not need to be a lawyer to do that. And so I'll just need to get clarification from her.
Okay. So Liz, will that come back to Pam or me in an email or something? We'll pass it on. Okay.
Yep, you got it.
Another quick question regarding, are all credentials processed the same or differently? So if you have to be credentialed for one thing, you have to go through it again, or how does that work?
Right. So what's going to happen is the credentialing happens in, there's two facets, county and role. So if you're a poll watcher, you have to get credentialed every time. And then if you become a monitor, you'll have to get credentialed to be a monitor.
Okay. Let me see. I think the last question I had here was, I think two different people asked kind of a similar question, is can there be Democratic committees in each of the 159 counties, or possibly are there Democratic committees or chair people representing each of the 159 counties?
Well, there certainly can. I mean, there certainly can.
Theoretically, okay.
Yeah, theoretically, yeah.
So as far as the state, are most of the counties represented or just the handful of bigger counties, or how does that work?
No, we have a lot. I don't have the number off the top of my head. I apologize, but the majority of counties have Dem committees. And those are committees that have gone through a credentialing process, right? Or in process of being credentialed. Like there's a couple of counties recently that got credentialed. So there's a formal process that they go through, and it's really the vast majority. We have a lot of counties that have Dem committees. And say in particular for vote review panel, right? That's typically the way that usually happens is the election supervisor, slow it down because I want you to hear it. Usually the election supervisor will call the county committees, either Republican or Democratic, and say, hey, we need some Dems to come on our vote review panel. Can you send me your list of names? Right now, what if you're a county that you don't have a Democratic committee? Who does that election supervisor reach out to? What happened in 2020 is there's this vote review panel program. I call a vote review panel / ballot duplication. I put those together always because often people do both. We've got a whole volunteer program for that. And in 2020, they had 159 counties, whether they had Democratic committees or not, they had outreach relationships and people at the table. And that's what we're shooting for again, absolutely. Because every ballot's going to count, as we know. We're going to want every single ballot to count. And they are going to want to, you know, and so it'll be, we want to hold our own. So we've got an amazing research team around that program that's back again in 2024 and is ready to do that work again.
Thank you. Becky, this question to you. We have a question about the SEB board members. How are we on time? Should we defer that question?
I wonder if there's any way, the question, Leslie, I think you'll be talking a little bit about that later in the meeting.
Yes.
Yeah, so if there are specific SEB questions, let's hold that. And if there are any other questions, maybe Liz could hang around just for a minute and see if anybody else puts questions in the chat. That doable?
Sure. Sure.
So last call for questions to Liz.
I did see one question there that says, where can friends in other states go to find out how to get involved in the voter protection efforts? And I don't know whether that's the same links or what there, if you could help us, mm-hmm. Liz.
Sure. So I sent a document to Pam and company, and there is a general voter protection link for anybody. And folks should fill that out. I do not think they have separated out of state at this point, Balls. So that will get you into the pipeline for sure. Absolutely. And at this point, even the other trainings could be done by people out of state. They're not going to, there's no way that it prohibits it. So maybe you're thinking, oh, I have, you know, I know my friend in California is going to come and wants to poll watch. She can sign up. right? And then I'm going to check in with my team about what provisions they are doing with their the out-of-state, because usually out-of-state becomes an entity in and of itself. I hope that answers sufficiently. We do have a link that you can sign up to, that anybody can sign up to get in the pipeline, and then there will be something carved out for out-of-state for sure.
We just posted that in the chat, by the way.
I know, Liz, you're so good.
Liz, will the Vote Cure team be up and running during early voting? Because it seems to me like they're going to be essential given what the board is trying to do. If people get to the polls and they find they're inactive, they're going to have to do provisional ballots, right?
Yeah, so we are, you know, working on that right now to, again, if you remember that box early, that strategy box of carve that strategy out. So we're in the process of building that. The other thing, when I came on and I was hearing folks talking, Claire talk about this inactive situation, definitely people should be checking their voter registration often. And there is some inconsistency. So you may pop up as inactive, and then you may pop up as active. That's all through the Secretary of State. It's not an easy answer. Then I would be in touch with the election office. But I think that there is some, we definitely encountered voters checking through MVP. I always think most valuable player, GA. And there were inconsistencies. And so people need to check often. And if you do have a question, you can check in with your election office, your local election office. That doesn't necessarily 100% give you foolproof that if you check another time. I mean, there is just this glitch that seems to be happening occasionally.
Yeah, I think what I'm saying is if they go and they get there and there's a mistake, they'll do a provisional ballot, even during early voting, right? I mean, that's the way that when you get to the polls, how they deal with it. And so I guess I'm asking, will we have cure teams in place even during early voting so that we can sort of mop up that mess?
Right. And what I said is that we're in the process of building that program out right now. So we're in the process of building out that strategy. So we're very aware of it, and we are going to have that at the front end, but I couldn't talk about it in any detail because it's literally being built as we speak.
Awesome. Thanks.
Y'all, thank you very much. In the interest of time, if anybody else has questions, would you put them in the chat? And maybe, Liz, are you willing to answer in the chat for a little bit?
Sure. Absolutely.
Thank you. Wonderful. Thanks so much for your time.
I think, PJ, you're gonna pop it to Pam.
Yes, I wanted. Well, I want.
Oh, PJ, you're muted.
Again, okay. I want to thank Liz and Leslie and Pam, Boucher, and everyone for this wonderful information. Those of us that are up there doing the work. And I do the early advanced voting. So Robin, in answer to your question about when they come in, I'm telling everybody that I canvass about what they need to do. There have been instances, the last election, that the person was able to get in touch with DeKalb voter registration, and she got it straightened out. I mean, they were actually able to straighten it out in the office, okay? So I just, you know, that's been great. Now, I'm going to talk in a minute, so let me shut up. At this point, I would like to introduce, I'm off my thing. I got so excited. Okay. Pam, at this point, can you help us with this next traveler reports and volunteer recruitment and lead this section on team reports?
Sure. Thanks so much, PJ. And just reiterating what Becky said at the very beginning and following up on the great information from Claire and Liz, we really want people to sign up. There are lots of folks on this call who have already doing things. We hope you will do more. There are folks on the call who maybe are just new and this would be a first opportunity. Again, we encourage you to sign up. As you listen to the team reports and think about what you've heard, go ahead and put your name, your email address, and your cell phone, if you would, in the main chat. Don't send it to the team lead. Send it in the main chat so that we have a record of that and can get back in touch with you with all of the necessary information. So with that, this is going to be an active recruitment area. And we're going to start off with something that is really exciting and that all of us can participate in. And so, Becky, can you tell us about that?
Absolutely. And those who have been around Necessary Trouble for a while know that when we choose candidates the way that we have chosen Jasmine Clark and Susie Greenberg, that at some point we always end up doing a Necessary Trouble-led fundraiser for them. And I want to really appreciate the fundraiser, the Troubler fundraiser team, which in addition to me has been Aquaria, Richardson Smith, Beth Levine, Raynell Solar, and Pat Bird. And that fundraiser is going to be actually instead of our next meeting, which is going to be Sunday, September 15th at 4 o'clock, will be a fundraiser for Susie Greenberg and Jasmine Clark. And the special speaker, we are really excited about this. The special speaker at that fundraiser will be Senator John Ossoff. And we're really thrilled about that. We have a couple of partners, grassroots partners. Some of the local Indivisible groups will be joining us in co-hosting that event. And this is in fact a recruitment, because we want to recruit you not just to come to that, but also in the next week to 10 days, we will be sending out the details and the graphic for that. And we would very much love if you would share that invitation, not just with, you know, not just to come yourself, but share that invitation to that fundraiser with in-state friends and even out-of-state friends, if you can communicate to those out-of-state friends how crucial it is that these two candidates win this election, both to because we are working for to flip the state house, and also because every voter that they turn out will also vote for Kamala Harris. So if you have a particular interest in helping us to promote it, please put your name and information in the chat. And otherwise, we are also hoping that everybody will pass the word about that fundraiser to all their contacts. We want to make this a really big one, and we really want to bring in some dollars to Susie and Jasmine. So thank you in advance for that.
Thank you so much, Becky. That sounds fantastic. And with that, let's return to the voter protection area. And Leslie, who is my co-lead, but is doing the yeoman's work on this, really, and especially in regard to the state election board and such. Leslie, would you give us some comments and updates?
I'm glad to. And I think we have a slide maybe on this, on the SEB. Thank you so much. There's the illustrious SEB. So let me start first, though, by saying about the Necessary Trouble team. We are now more than 40 troublers strong. So this is just a phenomenal response from you all. Thank you very, very much. Any of you who haven't had a chance to sign up, or if you're new today, please put your name in the chat and just put VOPRO, and we'll be sure to get you on the mailing list. Our focus this month has, in fact, been the State Election Board. And that is thanks to some dedicated troublers who have been going to these meetings, and they've helped us get organized around this. I'd like to give credit to them and to really give a shout out to four people specifically: Janet Grant, Betsy Shackelford, Pam Woodley, and Karen McCowan. They were the standout speakers at the last meeting. I mean, they were fantastic. So Necessary Trouble was there in force. There were about 10 of us. I also want to mention to any of you who haven't gone down to the Capitol, might be a little concerned about that, I'm not a regular Capitol goer. So I was really helped by the way Necessary Trouble has put this together. We had a team that met on the MARTA at East Lake, went down together, went through the security, found the rooms, got set up, had lunch together with like-minded people. It was a great day, and we seriously need you there if you can do it, because there are a lot of mega groups that are showing up, and it's just nice to know that there are lots of other folks in the room too. So if you can be there on the 19th, we did not go down as early as Liz had suggested, but you know, you can do that certainly. We'll have more information on that. Remember that prep rally, that was invaluable for the last meeting. So please do try to do that on the 13th. Let me just see what else I have. As Liz said, there'll be opportunities for the hotline, for poll watching, and possibly for special projects. Pam and I will keep you posted on those as they come in, and we'll try to answer questions or send reminders of how to sign up for any of that activity. If you have questions, just email us. Now, if you want to know more about the background on the SEB, there is a great source for that, and it's democracydocket.com. That's the person behind that is Mark Elias, who is like the foremost litigator across the country in election matters. They've had three or four good articles. Also, Rolling Stone has had two excellent articles on this, and we can provide those links to you. May I see the next slide? So here's some information on the SEB. And thanks to Janet Grant for putting this together. You see our outstanding speakers there at the podium. Let's see, anything we haven't covered? Okay, some of this, like item two, they'll go over in the prep meeting. So if that doesn't make any sense to you, you'll know all about it in the prep meeting. A good reminder, comments are limited to 2 minutes. So it's really important to get some help. If you haven't done this before, get your comments down to precise so you can say them in 2 minutes. And there's help from the DPG, as Liz said, for that. So I think that covers it for me. Unless Pam, is there anything from the committee you want to add?
No, only to say that the research component and such that that Liz mentioned, that there will be information forthcoming as those projects kind of come up and we pull together those teams. So again, just sign up and then there will be opportunities galore in voter protection.
Thank you. So that's it for us.
All right. And then related, actually, in a way, because we are liaising with in voter protection with Amy Carpenter, because there are things such as Liz mentioned about calling Democrats who have volunteered in the past or might be interested in volunteering and seeking recruits for things like poll watching and such. So that's, we are kind of working with our phone banking team, and Amy is leading that group. And can you talk to us about that? And,
yes.
And all other things.
Yes, thank you, Pam. Well, while we await the quote unquote after Labor Day phone banking instructions from the Greenberg and Clark campaigns, we do have opportunities to assist in the phone banking efforts from now until the end of August. These efforts are, in fact, voter protection projects, in that the purpose is the recruitment of poll watchers from a pool of friendly Dems, so it couldn't be any easier than that. After this meeting, I am sending an email to our entire group of Necessary Trouble phone bankers. We have about 30 of us, with the details such as the link to register for these August dates, the script, how to get an action ID ahead of phone banking time. So if you would like to join us and have not been receiving emails from me already regarding phone banking, just I'll reiterate, please put NTPB for Necessary Trouble phone banking in your email and your email in the chat now. By the way, these voter protection projects really do help us brush up on our phone banking skills for Susie and Dr. Clark. We had one phone banking effort to recruit poll watchers in July, end of July, and we are working with a particular DPG representative in fine-tuning, getting better, making sure we've got the right script so we can look at it ahead of time so that we'll know what will be. Apparently, some people, that is not an issue, but we have found out that our phone bankers prefer to be as informed as possible. So that's why we have gone the extra mile and working with one person at the DPG, and she sort of curated these three phone banking opportunities for August the 21st, 23rd, 28th. But this is what I am sending out via email after this meeting this evening. So if you are interested in joining us and even staying on, then hopefully, and getting involved with phone banking for the Greenberg and Clark campaign, we invite you to do so. It's perfect timing. Thanks.
You're muted, Pam.
Thank you, Amy. See, PJ, you're not the only one. I do that. Anyway, thanks very much, Amy. And obviously opportunities where folks are doing things for more than one activity, which is fantastic here. And speaking of which, Kate King, postcarding, always a popular activity here. Can you update us, please?
Yes, definitely. Very popular because it's easy, it's fun. You can do it in a few spare moments at a time. You can do it with friends. You can do it while you're cooking dinner. And it's also very effective. Postcarding can increase Democratic turnout by 1.3%. And that may sound small, but that's big. Between now and the election, we're going to have lots of postcarding opportunities. Right this very second, we have no postcards because y'all are doing too good a job. The coolers are empty right now. There will probably be new postcards as soon as tomorrow. And if you're not on my email list, please put your name and information in the chat to get on my email list. So as soon as there are postcards available, you will be among the first, well, you'll be in the first 100 people to hear about them. So that's about how many postcard volunteers we have now. I think as we go on to November 5th, the opportunities for postcarding are going to increase exponentially. We'll have lots more for Jasmine, for Susie. We've been doing them for the Fighting 50. So this is sort of a temporary lull before a lot of exciting postcard opportunities. And I hope we'll be able to have postcard parties. We did it a few times in the last cycle. We have wanted to do it all through the summer, but you go through the postcards too fast. You know, we can't have a postcard party if there's only 40 postcards left. So if you're interested in hosting, send me an email and we will figure out how that can be done. You know, right now we don't have enough postcards to do it with, but that day will come. And I think that's about all I've got to say about postcards. Pam, you're muted.
Thank you, Kate. I think that those postcards will definitely be coming and such here. And just to reiterate one thing that Kate and Amy have both said, a number of you might be already on a list. So sign up only if, in fact, you are not already on that list and you will be added. And with that, we're going to talk about canvassing because these are our folks who are going out in this 100 degree weather and such and already canvassing for Susie Greenberg and Jasmine Clark. Naomi Bach, and you update? Yes.
Thank you. So as you said, we started canvassing for the two candidates that we're supporting. Dr. Jasmine Clark and Susie Greenberg in May. We go out one Saturday morning a month for one of the candidates and a couple of weeks later, Saturday morning for the other candidate. It's all notified ahead of time. To date, we've knocked on 1,660 doors. We have 53 canvassers signed up so far, but if you would like to do it, please put your name and email and canvassing in the chat. Sometimes we get really rewarding information. Yesterday in particular, several people talked about having never voted Democratic before, but this time around they were. So that just cheers everyone up. So let us know if you have any questions and we'll get the time and date and meeting place to you. Thank you.
Could I interject here just as the chat manager? I have put a canvassing link into the chat and you can sign up directly there. You can just click that link and sign up for our current events, canvassing events.
Great. Thanks so much, Naomi, and also Karen here. That makes it Karen and Naomi and Ham Woodley and Oak and Tara. You all make it so easy for the volunteers and such. So appreciate that. And the canvassing, and as Becky said, when you go to those doors, you are supporting those two House candidates, but it also is supporting the Harris-Walz campaign as well, helping to turn Georgia blue, well, turn the House blue. And that will help us in our gerrymandering or anti-gerrymandering efforts as well. So with that, and now, sort of a form of canvassing. PJ is going to talk to us about the Neighbor to Neighbor program, which we learned about at our last meeting.
Okay, thank you so much, Pam. Yes, at our last meeting, we had a representative from the Neighbor to Neighbor. It's like canvassing, although it's not as detailed. Actually, what they're concentrating on is getting information. They give us names. Once you sign up, they give you 10 names to begin with. And you have preferences as to what territory. In other words, around my neighborhood, I asked for like 2 miles. I wanted names and of Democrats now, not Republicans. These are known Democrats and loyal Democrats. And I wanted it within a 2 mile radius. So I got my first 10 names and the first list went just fine because most of them were in my community where I live in my subdivision. But then it started to branch off into the neighboring subdivision. The one thing I'm finding out in my neighborhood, it was a piece of cake. But as I go into the other neighborhoods, I just want you to know, it's not that it's dangerous or anything like that, but there are hiccups. Like I went to one gentleman's house and he let me know that he was a convicted felon and he didn't want me parking in his driveway. Well, my hip hurt that day, so I parked in his driveway. But that's just one of the things. What I do is I usually take the letter that they give us, the introductory letter, and there's also some more information that I pass on about the Democrats. They have several of these, what do you call these codes that you take a picture of? You all, what are those?
Oh, the QR codes.
That's it, QR codes, okay. And so it has the QR code for REACH, which is part of the Democratic, the Dems, and it gives information about resources, where you can go to find resources. And then you'd have another QR code that if you do that, it'll tell you where the events are taking place. And that way you can sign up as you want. But the whole thing doesn't take but a few minutes. And it was interesting that I was on the phone with my daughter and she lives in Michigan, okay? And we were on the phone and she said, well, hold on, mother. And the lady came to the door, told her who she was, gave her the piece of paper and she was gone. And I said, that sounds like Neighbor to Neighbor. What paper did she give you? And it was Neighbor to Neighbor. So Indivisible has a nationwide effort. This is a nationwide effort and it's a form of canvassing, not quite like what was explained to us today about taking the time if they want to talk, but for the most part they just kind of want you to give them the information and go on about your business. But I'm enjoying it. The 100 degree weather, that you can keep that, but it's another form of being able to keep in touch. Also, it's a way to find out. Some of the information they sent me, they didn't have the right name for the person at that address. And one of the people, they had been voting forever and I knew them, but they had a different name on the contact sheet. So I'm just, if I get to talk to somebody, then I document that. Out of my first 10, I was able to talk to 8 people. I only had to leave information for 2. So that's about all I have. I mean, it's not hard. It's good, and I'm enjoying it. But you do have some hiccups, okay? You know, folks may not be receptive and they may not open the door. And a lot of the people have these phone things now and they say, I can't come to the door right now. I can't talk to you. So I just make sure that when I go back out to the mailbox, I take the paperwork and put it on the side of the mailbox, not in their mailbox, but on the side so that they, when they come home, they'll see it sticking up. So that's about it. And oh, when you finish 10, they give you 10 more, and then 10 more, and then 10 more, and it goes on and on and on.
A multiplier effect here. Thanks, yes, so much, yes, yes. DJ. And actually, I'm going to turn this all back over, the whole show back over to you to close us out.
All right. Thank you so much, Pam. And thanks to all the troublers and the hard work that we're doing and all the leads, Leslie High, Amy Carpenter, Kate King, Naomi Bach, Pam, for your expertise in the IT department, you a senior moment. Anyway, thanks everybody, okay? Our next meeting, we're gonna close the meeting, and our next meeting will not be, as Becky said, the traditional meeting, but rather a 1 hour virtual fundraiser for Jamie Clark and Susie Greenberg, with Senator John Ossoff as our speaker. So please mark your calendars for September the 15th from 4 to 5 p.m., okay? Now I want to turn it over to Becky for our closing song. And I thank everybody for coming.
Wonderful. Thank you, PJ. And our thanks also to everybody who's participated. And as people know, if you need to jump off, you are welcome to jump off. But this is a really good song, and it's a really fun song, and it's a really good song for this moment. So if you can hang in here for 3 more minutes, I would love to play this for you. Give me a minute.
Way back when, in the beginning of time, man made the fire, then the wheel, went from a horse to an automobile. He said the world in mind, he took the oceans and the sky, he set the borders.
All right. Wasn't that worth it?
Yes.
Can we just do something? Can we, PJ, can we invite everybody to just unmute themselves and give a big shout out for Kamala Harris for this moment in time?
Yes. Woo.
And for also all the great work the Troublers are doing. So much. Thank you for all the women and all the men too.
Yeah.
And let's get to, we'll just jump right in and do more work and hopefully see everybody in September at the fundraiser.
Thank you. Thank